Those strange conical objects you might have seen in pictures from the core of Chernobyl Reactor 4. These are devices known as buoys. Yet, few people know that in the summer of 1986, they became a cornerstone of vital research, guiding truly critical decisions. This is the first in-depth look at this ambitious project, its design, history, and legacy. It was June 1986, 1.5 months after the Chernobyl disaster. Despite many attempts, the temperature and thermal processes inside the destroyed reactor 4 remained a mystery. It was clear they were changing, but getting exact readings was crucial to plan the next actions. Many scientists were trying to find a way. Among them was Spartak Belyaev, one of scientists of the expedition of Kurchatov Nuclear Institute deployed in the zone. He was the one who proposed the solution, and later he recalled. We tried different methods. We created a flat smoke screen and, by observing the rising waves, identified the nuclear fuel by convective air flows. By measuring the temperature and speed of these flows, we could roughly estimate the amount of fuel. Then we tried placing sensors on cables from helicopters, but they either broke apart or failed because they landed on completely unknown surfaces. We needed a reliable system, so we started to brainstorm. There were ideas to make balloons with detectors or a cable line above the reactor, or even do laser scanning. In reality, I cannot already recall our ideas, but eventually we came to the concept of what we called the buoy. Simply put, the buoys were envisioned as rugged detection nodes that would form a network to monitor the reactor 24/7. But they had to survive literally the unknown. This challenge was taken on by the team of Oleg Gerashenko, head of the Institute of Technical Thermal Physics, based here in Kiev. By this time, he and his group had already spent a month in the zone, developing countless detectors for temperature and thermal flux. These detectors were chosen for the buoys, because they could operate in truly extreme conditions. And just a few weeks earlier, they had proven their potential. There was a fear that molten fuel would burn through the foundation of Reactor 4, so miners dug a tunnel ending in a chamber beneath the reactor. The plan was to install cooling machines there, but when the chamber was ready, a few detectors designed by Gerashenko's team showed there were no longer any risk. So instead, the chamber was filled with concrete, reinforcing the structure from below. Approaching the reactor core, however, was a next-level mission. The Institute created two types of buoys, which somewhat looked as small space probes. Each was a tripod designed for stable contact with the surface, holding three detectors. Well, these buoys appeared to be really reliable, but they were not really optimized for helicopter deployment. So, to overcome this, Gerashenko's team joined forces with the Kurchatov Institute to create a new version. It was a round cone, equipped with a ring of lead blocks as a counterweight. Inside, it had a cross-shaped mount, securing a central rod with a powerful spring. Then, below, there was an assembly with two thermal flux detectors, each equipped with a nickel thermometer. So, when deployed, the spring would push them firmly to the surface to take readings. There were also two extra copper thermometers for air, a gamma radiation detector, and six anemometers to monitor convection flow. Those anemometers were paired, with one positioned horizontally and one vertically. All detectors and sensors were connected to central junction box, which also housed a preamplifier to strengthen the signals. From this box extended the 200-meter main cable used for data transmission and power. All of this was housed in a metal casing painted white-yellow or white-blue and marked with a large visible number. At the top was a transportation ring designed to use with either a helicopter or a demag crane. The device weighed 300 kilograms or 660 pounds. The first batch of 10 buoys was prepared and tested near the helipad in the city of Chernobyl. Then they were gradually transported to the power plant for positioning. Locations were defined using stationary and airborne gamma visors, which we recently told you about. The first buoy was placed on August 5, 1986. Each deployment was a complex operation, but the helicopter pilots achieved remarkable precision, placing them within 1 meter of the target. Once a buoy was placed, the helicopter carefully positioned the cable over the ruins. Only then it was jettisoned near the auxiliary reactor systems building. The cable was manually collected, attached to a rope and dragged inside the building where the monitoring equipment was deployed. Not everything went well. Some buoys hit debris during placement, leaving total 97 of 127 detectors operational. But even this provided vital 24/7 data. And this is where the first batch of 10 buoys was placed. Then, on August 17, a fire which happened during welding of sarcophagus parts damaged cables from buoys 3, 7 and 8. Only buoys 3 and 8 were eventually restored. 1 month later, by September 17, due to intensive sarcophagus construction, many cables were cut, leaving stable data only from buoys 2 and 4. So, 5 more buoys were prepared, and then they were placed using demag cranes, which provided higher precision than helicopters. For example, this allowed buoys 14 and 15 to be positioned directly on a skim E of the reactor, where they remain to this day. And here is the only footage of the buoys program computer screens showing temperature data. The data came to a Kamak crate connected to an M6000, a PDP-compatible computer located in the safe part of the power plant. Apart from these screens and journals, it was also recorded on punch tape and transmitted via dedicated modem line to the Khrushchev Institute. By November 1986, most buoys had gone offline, leaving only the Buoy 11 transmitting data. But at that moment, it was a lesser problem because aggregated information already helped to make very important conclusions. It revealed a steady and predictable decline in thermal parameters. Also, power of radiation was reducing to half approximately every 60 days, in line with theoretical calculations. In other words, this confirmed that there were no dangerous changes in the behavior of nuclear fuel. And there were no signs of self-sustaining chain reaction, which many feared about. Moreover, the findings from Program Buoy allowed scientists to calculate the total residual heat release from fission products. And in this way, they could estimate the amount of nuclear fuel remaining inside the reactor building. The conclusion? Over 90% of reactor's fuel remained within its walls. And all that made Program Buoy a great success. When the sarcophagus was completed, the loss of data from buoys had to be compensated. So, portable equipment was used to identify new monitoring points and detectors were installed inside the sarcophagus, mostly in its lower sections and through the drills. Additionally, from the roof, ionization chambers and temperature sensors were lowered into the space above the ruins. These were later connected to existing monitoring systems, forming diagnostics network called Finish and Shatter. These two computer systems marked the next phase in understanding and controlling the wreckage of Reactor 4. But this is a story for one of our future episodes. Professor Spartak Belyaev continued his work in the zone, serving as the scientific head of the complex expedition of the Khrushchev Institute from 1987 until 1992. He passed away in 2017, leaving behind a great scientific legacy. For Oleg Gerashenko, his tireless work in the zone during the most challenging period ultimately defined his fate. Despite his ambitious plans for future, Professor passed away in 1992. His contributions, however, remain vital to the story of Chernobyl and thermal physics in general. If you made it this far, thank you for watching. We'll add a lot of translated bonus reading about Program Buoy on our Patreon page, so check it out to learn more. The link is in the description below. This episode is a part of a series, so check out our other documentaries because we have many, many interesting things to watch. And see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.